Sometimes you just need that one file, and it'd be really nice if you just had a simple application that ran in a web browser that gave you access to your files. Well, today we're going to be taking a look at CopyParty. This turns almost any device into a file server. It's a really simple Python application that did the rounds a few months ago. It's just taken me a while to get around to covering it. And this application, we are going to run in a container. We're going to put on our tailnets, of course, because that's what we do here on the Tailscale channel. I'm also going to show you some new Docker Compose secrets, tricks of how you can configure not only the CopyParty application itself directly in your Compose YAML files, but also the Tailscale Serve sidecar piece directly in your Docker Compose YAMLs as well. Now, I'll put a link in the description to all of the materials about CopyParty, such as this fantastic YouTube video, 16 minutes long. It goes through all of the different features that CopyParty has. It's brilliant. It does a better job than I could possibly manage. We're going to focus, like I say, on the Docker Compose aspects today and deploying this thing onto your tailnet. Now, you've seen on the channel many times before that I deploy applications with the main application and then a Tailscale sidecar container. And the downside of that, in fact, if you look in this long list of apps we've covered on this channel over the years, the downside of that is that you need this kind of sidecar volume mounted serve.json file. It's a very simple file. All it essentially does is it tells the Tailscale Serve to listen on port 443 to proxy this port from inside the container onto your tailnet using Tailscale Serve. And I've always wished that there was a simple way to do that without bind mounting a separate file. Well, I found one. It's been right under my nose this whole time. Docker Compose has this configs top level element built into the YAML configuration schema of Docker Compose. So what we can do is we can define, okay, this is just the JSON blob we looked at earlier, kind of minified-ish, so that it fits more comfortably inside our Compose file and doesn't like word wrap or anything. What we can do is we can define these elements inside our config files, and then we can reference them later on inside our configurations. That's it. That's the cool trick. So what this does is it ingests this content block up here, lines 4 through 8, and then spits it out into a file inside the remote container. So let's take a little look at the CopyParty application itself. It is super basic. It's just a file browser that runs inside a web browser, effectively. You know, I can select an image, I can view an image, I can go through here and look at my obsession with the Volkswagen Golf. This was Wookiees in the Woods, by the way, a few years ago. Fantastic event if you're a Volkswagen enthusiast like me. And, you know, I can see all of my images that I've taken over the years. In fact, these are the same images that were powering the image video that came out last week. So I'm going to log in now using the username and password configured in my Compose file. It literally right now is change me. And now I just want to create a new directory. I'm just going to call this test because I want to show you how fast this thing is. I'm going to bring up a directory full of a bunch of test photos. And then if I just drop this into the browser like so, ready? Here we go. We're uploading, I don't know, 22 files. And that's it, it's done. And we can now bring these up full screen and have a look at them. We can download them, we can fettle them, we can rotate them. It also supports rich media. So if you've got an audio file, for example, let me look on my desktop where I've almost certainly got a recording that I'm using for this video. Let me just upload that here. And we can play those audio files in the browser. There we go. So now I can just, you know, I could use this as a podcast, like a low rent podcast player if I wanted to. The other option it does as well, can I see? Yeah, it renders the spectral like waveform of the file. I just think that's a really cool, nice little touch from CopyParty. There are tons and tons and tons of other features to this thing. For example, if I wanted to download the entire directory as a zip file, which can be really handy sometimes, I just click this little button down here. No right-click menus, no doing silliness. And there you go. There's my test directory now as a zip file on my local system. There is a way you can mount CopyParty as a web dev. So if you go up to this option up here and say connect, you can basically turn your CopyParty instance into like a remote file server, you know, that appears as a mounted network share inside your computer. And you can, of course, do this all over Tailscale when it's on your tailnet. And he supports multiple different ways. You've got WebDAV, you've got PartyFuse, iShare, As well as all the different operating systems using our clone and all the other stuff that exists in the world. I can't say enough good things about this app, honestly. It's really simple. It's really simple considering it's just a bunch of Python. And it just does what it needs to do really well. So let's take a little look at some of the lifecycle stuff around the config stanzas inside Docker Compose. You can see that, as I showed you earlier, we have the Tailscale Serve configuration, but we also have the CopyParty configuration as well. It's a very simple application to configure, and so I thought it was a perfect example for today's video. You can see how the config for TS Serve gets reused later on in the file just down here, and then the same thing applies also to the CopyParty configuration as well. So how does this get passed through on the remote side? What does it look like inside the container? Well, let's take a look at the CopyParty TS Serve container. We're going to look inside CopyParty TS. Now, I've SSH'd into fake NAS, which is where this application is actually running, and I'm going to do this command, docker exec CopyParty TS, and I want to see what the config looks like, the serve config looks like, inside that remote container. Because if we look at the YAML file, look, this gets passed through and mapped almost as a target in /config/serve.json, which is the file path here that I'm going to print out to the terminal and we're going to have a look at. And you can see this block here matches perfectly this block here inside my compose file. But what if I want to make a change? This is where it can get a little bit, I don't know, like I just expected it to work a different way than what it actually does, but we'll get there. Let's make the change to the compose YAML file, and I want to change Tailscale funnel to be true for this node, for example. Now, if I do that and modify the compose file and then do a docker compose restart, I've restarted the CopyParty and the CopyParty Tailscale containers, the sidecars. But if I do the same exec command, look, it still says false, even though that our compose file says, our survey says, even though our compose file says true right here. And it does seem logical that that would work, doesn't it? But the problem here is that the restart process only stops the process inside the container and then starts the container again. It doesn't run any of the container creation or instantiation routines that look at the config files in your YAML file. It doesn't recompute the hash and say, hey, something's changed, we should probably update this. The container itself will still exist, the same container, the same file system, the same mounted configuration object from when it was first created. Compose won't go back and read that config file until you recreate the container. So that leaves us with really only a couple of options, and the one that I've sort of landed on is to use docker compose up force recreate. So this is a lifecycle issue. So if we can do a force recreate, then we're all good to go. So I'm going to do this. I'm going to do docker compose up minus d dash dash force recreate. And look what happens to our YAML file. Our funnel block now reads true. So if you're using these config blocks to define configs for applications, you need to understand that they work differently to bind mounts. They don't update in real time inside the container. Docker compose only reads these config blocks at container creation time, at container instantiation time. So to make a change to those underlying configs and for them to be passed through to the containers, you just have to recreate the container every time. It's a small workflow tweak, but a really, really important one. So that's kind of the gotcha with Docker compose configs. They're read once when the container is created, and then they're locked in until you recreate that container completely. It's not obvious, and the docs don't exactly make this crystal clear, that whole life cycle of the container piece. So hopefully this saves some of you from the debugging headache that I had today. So let me know in the comments what other stuff is hiding in the Docker Compose documentation that I've probably completely missed. This has been one of my favorite little discoveries of the last few weeks. Now, I have to say a great big thank you to all of you for watching throughout 2025. And here is to a prosperous and successful 2026 to all of you. Thank you so much for watching. I've been Alex from Tailscale.